Michigan is gearing up to conduct audits of its November election as President Trump and his allies continue to raise unfounded doubts about its integrity. The state certified its results about 3 weeks ago after President-elect Biden won by more than 154,000 votes. Democratic Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson says these post-election audits will be the, quote, most comprehensive in Michigan's history. And Secretary of State Benson is joining me now to discuss this. So, you probably knew you were going to be very busy in 2020 with these elections. Probably not this busy, though. As I understand it, the decision to go forward with the audits, that happened even before this election, before all the questions. But tell me, you know, what does the timeline look like and what does the process look like?
Well, thanks for having me. And yes, we have been planning these audits for nearly 2 years now. The first and most significant change is we are doing a statewide risk-limiting audit. Now, these are the most statistically reliable types of audits. They look at the paper ballots. Every voter in Michigan votes on a paper ballot and then ensures that the machines accurately counted those ballots and finds ways to, in addition to affirming that, improve the efficiency of the process in the future. So it's an affirmation that everything was accurate and by the book. And we did one of these in our March presidential primary, and they similarly found accuracy. So we're anticipating the same here. So it's really an affirmation that the ballots were correctly counted. And then in addition to that, we're doing local audits to look into times in which at the precinct level, there may have been an imbalance in the precinct found during the canvassing process. And that helps us just explain why you may have one voter signed in a precinct, but voting in another precinct. That typically happens when a voter shows up to the wrong precinct, but procedural audits help us do a deeper dive there and just record what happened for posterity's sake.
You know, in any other year, this would just be sort of the general responsible thing to do, make sure all the systems are working as one expects them to do. But this year is completely different. Are you hoping that perhaps once this audit is through, this will change the minds of those who are skeptical about how Michigan ran its election?
Of course we're hoping that, because the bottom line is that the truth is that our elections in Michigan and nationwide were among the most secure and accessible in our country's history and in our state's history. So we've been doing everything we can here in Michigan to reaffirm that to the American public and to our voters amidst this historic onslaught of misinformation that's been designed to lie to voters about that truth. And so these audits will be another piece of evidence, another actual example of how exactly secure and accurate these elections were. We hope that we believe that for many, and in fact, the most of our citizens, they will see this as an additional affirmation of the accuracy of the election. But we can't underestimate the damage that's being done by these baseless lawsuits and politically charged legislative hearings and a number of other things that are designed to both curry favor with an outgoing president and also lie to the voters about the sanctity of their elections.
So speaking of those lawsuits, Michigan Attorney General Dana Nessel, along with the attorneys general from Georgia, from Pennsylvania, from Wisconsin, they are asking the Supreme Court to dismiss what, you know, to be flattering, you could call it a long shot lawsuit. You could call it a lot of other things, too, from the Texas Attorney General, right? The Republican-backed suit seeks to overturn the results of those four states where voters picked President-elect Biden. Now, the U.S. runs the federal elections on a state level, so I'm wondering if you were concerned about the precedent being set here. When I heard that Texas was initiating this lawsuit, I just thought it doesn't seem plausible. And I also thought, well, a lot of people were pretty upset about the way Texas ran its election. There was a lot of criticism. They're not facing lawsuits. How can this be done? Are you concerned, you know, moving forward that we'll see more of these?
Yeah, I mean, these post-election shenanigans where the legal system is used to further political and, you know, PR narratives is very dangerous, and it cannot become the norm, and it's not going to become the norm. Myself and attorney generals who are on the right side of history, as well as secretaries of state who are almost universally saying our votes should count because that's what democracy is about, we are going to continue to work to just, again, tell the public the truth despite these baseless lawsuits like this one. I mean, look, the Michigan voters didn't mess with Texas, so I don't know why they're messing with us or any other state. And I'm grateful for the Republican Attorney General in Ohio and the attorney generals all around the country who've been saying that truth. And I question, as a former law school dean, why any attorney, particularly an attorney general, would put their name on a lawsuit or support a lawsuit that is clearly so politically driven, clearly is going to be dismissed, and clearly is designed solely to confuse American voters about the actual truth of this election, which was that it was secure and accessible.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the meantime, there are many, many voices sort of continuing to yell on top of the mountain, this was a successful, secure, without fraud election. One of them is the former top election security official, Chris Krebs. He is now suing the Trump campaign, accusing the campaign of defamation over its sometimes violent rhetoric targeting those defending election integrity. You know all about that. This weekend, you had armed protesters outside your home, where you and your family were, and you spoke very openly about what that experience was like. You know, I'm sure that when you took on this job, you did not think that you would find yourself in a situation where you were concerned about your personal safety. What do you want people to know about these threats and about this sort of, you know, I'll say loose language that we hear coming from people who have a platform. And, you know, and then we hear people sort of back off and go, oh, I was just being sarcastic. But this is the sort of language that fuels behavior that we really don't know, you know, how far it could go.
Absolutely. And I'll say two things on that. One, you know, my experience personally was not an isolated incident. I mean, as you mentioned, Chris Krebs, my colleagues in Georgia, Arizona, Pennsylvania, Nevada, and many other local election administrators at the local level have been experiencing an increase in the vitriol and in the hateful rhetoric and the violent threats in the month that since the polls closed on this election and the winners began to be known. So that said, it's time for everyone with a platform to condemn these hateful words, this hateful rhetoric, stop using it, certainly, and get on the side of the truth and start telling the truth to the American voter about exactly how secure and accurate and reliable the results of this election were. And then we also, secondly, have to realize that if that doesn't happen and if this escalation continues, and that's really what I feel we're seeing right now, an escalation of this vitriol and rhetoric, then we are going to see that potentially transform into violent acts against election administrators, and that is very real. I started my career investigating hate groups and hate crimes around the country. We know that all the data shows that hateful rhetoric, particularly from leaders, leads to hateful actions by particularly followers of those leaders. And so recognizing that basic academic data, it's time for everyone to just lay down their swords, recognize the truth, and in this, the interest of our voters and the safety of elected leaders throughout our country, just simply start moving on so that we can begin the healing process of coming out of this election in a way that will reaffirm citizens' rightly placed faith in our elections processes and also help us solve the many problems that every elected official should have on their agenda to solve moving forward.
Michigan Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson, thank you so much for joining us. Stay safe and have a good weekend.
Thank you. You too.